Hey, what's going on, Hayden?
Not too much. Adam Patrick Murray.
Yeah, yeah, sweet. Let's play some Battlefield 1. Just came out today.
Yeah, it came out today, and we are going to just probably play the intro mission, Storm of Steel. It's not super long, but I think it is a pretty good look at the Battlefield campaign and the tone that they're taking.
Yeah, which is pretty serious.
Yeah, it's very grim and solemn. And yeah, this mission in particular might be one of my favorite shooter missions this year. I think they do a really good job with it thematically.
And you beat this whole game, right?
Yes, I've beat this whole game. It's not very long. It's like 6 hours.
Oh, okay.
It's kind of nice because it's split up into like 6 different campaigns, and it feels sort of like a TV show where you're like, I could just play another. It's only going to be like 40 minutes. This is fine.
Well, and I mean, you've played almost every Battlefield game, right?
Yes. And I might have played every Battlefield.
You think this is the best campaign they've done so far?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean,
hands down.
Our runner up is, I guess, the Bad Company campaign.
Yeah.
But 3 and 4 were terrible, so.
So he's pretty serious, getting a little flashback action here.
Yeah, and these are the Harlem Hellfighters, which was a black unit during World War I. They're famous for that reason.
Yeah, I'll preface this. I don't really know much about World War I. I wasn't paying attention in history class.
You're the target audience for this game, then.
Yeah, well, I was pretty confused through most of what I've played so far.
I think DICE said that they hope that this game will like renew interest in World War I.
Really?
Yeah, it's kind of fascinating.
I am interested.
They did give you an intro.
I know. I was like, that's when this happened. Okay. I know the years. It ended nothing.
Yeah, World War One is pretty horrific, but.
Well, and I think when they announced it when did they announce this? Actually, I don't remember.
May
at E3 or before?
No, before E3.
I mean, everyone was a little worried they weren't gonna be able to hold up to the source material. You know, it was a nasty, dirty war, but. Do you feel like they respected the what's
going
on? In
the single player, yeah. The multiplayer is just Battlefield as usual, but the single player is done much better. So yeah, as they said, this is frontline combat. You are not expected to survive, but we'll hopefully survive for a little bit here.
I know, actually, the in a little bit I was faced up against a flamethrower guy, and I was able to hold him off for like, I don't know, maybe like 5 minutes. And I was like, I'm dumping so many rounds into this guy, but I can't keep going.
Yeah, those flamethrower thrower guys are way overpowered, especially in multiplayer.
Yeah.
They are a killer.
So I should also mention we're playing this on a Falcon Northwest Fragbox 2 with a 10-core Broadwell E. Or is it 8-core? I think it's actually just the 8-core.
Probably the 8-core.
And then 2 Titan X Pascals. So, you know.
It is one hell of a machine. We are running this at 4K 60 frames per second right now.
And super smooth, man. It looks nice, especially the lens flares and everything.
Yep.
I'm a big fan of it. Very cinematic.
Wait until you get... There's a set of missions that take place. You're a pilot.
Uh-huh.
And man, some of the sun work in that is beautiful.
Ah, nice. I totally didn't even think about the air combat stuff in the campaign. That's good to know. Spoilers. Just kidding.
Spoilers, yeah.
Uh-oh, out of ammo.
Oh boy, this pistol.
So the review is live, and what did you give it?
We gave it a 9, so second highest score that we could give. I don't think it really does enough to warrant a full 10 score, but man, it is a great game.
And why don't you think it goes all the way to 10 or 11?
I just don't. I mean, it is like at its core just Battlefield, which is not necessarily a reason to. That's the end of us, maybe. Not necessarily a reason to penalize a game for just being a dumb shooter, but it is a. A bit of a dumb shooter.
It does what it needs to do.
Yep. So yeah, this is so the idea behind this mission in particular is you actually jump through a bunch of soldiers.
From all over the world, so many of us thinking this war would be our rite of passage, our great adventure.
And it sets a different tone, I feel too, because it's like hey, you know, there were so many people who died in this war that it's just like, all right, you know, you played one guy's vignette and you moved on to the next one. You're not just one guy going through the whole world or whole war and like saving the world.
Yeah, it reminds me a lot of like Call of Duty in its best moments, where you like get a bunch of different viewpoints. But this is like compressed down into one mission where you get a bunch of viewpoints like that, and so it's kind of cool because it feels much different than like the standard Call of Duty. Like, oh boy, I'm these three guys, and we're gonna save everything.
Yeah,
this feels like you're just like a soldier in a conflict that's much bigger than you.
Yeah, you're not out to win the war. You're just out to complete your missions.
Yep,
is the tone I got. And we won't say what happens at the end, but is that kind of, do they keep that tone through the whole thing?
They do. This is like six mini campaigns, each about an hour long. So, as I said, I think it's like more TV show-esque. Like, I'm really bad because I don't watch a lot of movies anymore because they're so long that I find it very hard to sit down and like convince myself to spend 2 hours watching something.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll gladly watch like four episodes of a TV show in the same amount of time. Because why not?
Yeah.
This sort of feels that way. Like, I could sit down and play one of these stories in about an hour and have a really good time, which makes it a lot easier to play than, like, a six-hour campaign all at once. Oh, God, this guy's taking us out.
I know, right? Would you say you like that trend in games lately where, you know, you kind of, they present it almost as a season, kind of like Hitman and, Quantum Break?
Especially with this, like, I think that it gives them a lot more freedom to experiment. Like, as we said, there's a whole chapter that's just about, like, a pilot in the RAF, the Royal Air Force in Britain. And there's a chapter where you play as a tank driver, and there's a chapter where you are, like, a guerrilla operative under Lawrence of Arabia. That sort of like, hey, we only need to spend an hour on this. That sort of pacing gives them a lot of room to do some crazy stuff that you wouldn't necessarily do if you had like, I don't know, 6 hours that you had to devote to one topic that really only has an hour of material to go through.
Yeah, yeah.
I really like it for this in particular. I hope we see more of it in shooters. I also think it helps them get away with some of the things that are traditionally pretty weak about Battlefield single player, which is like, hey, these characters have no character development and like no depth. When you're only with them for like an hour, you don't really care because you're just like getting like a vignette or like a sketch quality about like what this character is and what their key traits are.
Well, and I think it helps to vary up the gameplay as well, because in something like Call of Duty, you're put in as the same character. You're put in all these different kinds of scenarios, and it's like, oh wow, how did he, you know?
Yeah, they have to like contrive a reason for it to happen.
Yeah.
Whereas here, it's like, okay, now I'm playing as the pilot guy, so I'm just gonna play my pilot.
That makes
stuff.
Sense.
But yeah, I think it's a really good trend here. I hope that we see Battlefield stick with this, and in fact, like, I'm kind of hoping we get some single player DLC, because I would take, you know, two or three more 1 hour campaigns, which seems much more feasible for DICE to put out than like, hey, we need to put out like a, you know, an extra 2 hour, 3 hour expansion or something,
and try to like figure out how it actually blends in with the original.
Yeah, exactly.
So I'm once again, I'm not a history buff, so I'm not versed on the actual weaponry. Do you know how accurate the weaponry is in this?
It's pseudo-accurate. So, like, for instance, the British did have tanks in World War I, and they looked like this. But, like, tanks in World War I were actually, like, sort of death traps. Like, they were very imposing, but also very vulnerable. Mm-hmm. Whereas, like, here, like, especially in multiplayer, tanks can just, like, wreck entire crews.
Yeah, I was in a fight last night where I don't know what kind of tank it was, but there was six positions and it got filled up with six different people. Like, you know, so the guy at the front who I assume was driving and doing something with the turret, and then five more people like around
windows.
Yeah,
one of
windows.
Those crazy like hedgehog.
Yeah,
vehicles.
And that, man, we just wrecked shop, and especially when somebody would be able to pop out and repair it, like that was super fun.
Well, and like this part is interesting to me because like they give you a little bit of like trench warfare and the gas attacks that are iconic for World War I.
They don't seem to be going too far down that road, though.
Yeah, well, and they definitely don't. So, like, Verdun, there's another World War One shooter that came out a year or two ago mm-hmm. called Verdun. And they were, like, very history-focused. In fact, their main multiplayer mode was, like, a twist on trench warfare,
mm-hmm.
where you would, like, hear the whistle blow, and your team had a certain amount of time to attack. And if they were taken out, then the other team would run back, which is, like, pretty much how trench warfare worked in World War One. Like, you never had both sides attacking at the same time. It was basically, like, one side would be like, all right, we're going to attack now and run over to the other side's trenches, and the other side would just defend.
That's interesting.
So, like, that was a really cool way to, like, bring that aspect into multiplayer. Battlefield does not do anything like that. Like, yeah. Battlefield multiplayer is just like, yo, we're just going to run around and kill anything that moves. It just feels like Battlefield with, like, a World War One skin on it. But I do think, like, for the purposes of single player, they do a pretty good job of picking battles that are not heavy trench warfare battles, so you don't really have that problem.
I mean, after playing a little bit of this, like I said, I'm not too far in, probably a couple missions in. I'm actually pretty interested in that World War II shooter you just mentioned. What was that?
World War One, actually.
Verdun.
The problem with Verdun is the community was very small and kind of dead now.
Oh. Do you think it'll see an uptick from this or no?
I don't know. I feel like Battlefield 1 kind of cannibalized their... Because it was mostly people that wanted, like, a old school type of shooter, like a 1942 or earlier shooter.
They push.
But yeah, I think that this mission really does a good job of, like, summing up or setting the stage for,
every once in a while,
like, the jumping between viewpoints quality and the I'm a soldier in a much bigger conflict.
Yeah.
Especially, like, this shot is beautiful. And then, yeah, they kind of foreshadow the whole, like, all five campaigns after that in this moment.
Which a lot of this we saw in the trailers.
Yeah, the initial
to it, right?
Trailers, yep. Like, for instance, that train that just crashed through that car was that's part of the Lawrence of Arabia campaign.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously that's Lawrence of Arabia. And then, yeah, there's a whole pilot section, as I said. There's a British tank driver section, which you've already played.
Yep, yep.
That's the first one. But yeah, so that's the intro mission.
Nice.
To Battlefield 1.
Before we wrap it up, how is it running on your machine? I mean, obviously we have a beefy PC.
It's running
here.
Fine. I mean, so I'm not running. I still run 1080p because I've got my 144 hertz monitor, so I like having that speed and the headroom to hit 144 hertz. Mm. I don't know exact numbers because I haven't been running a frame rate counter, but. It's been totally smooth. I would say I'm probably getting like 75, 80 frames per second.
Nice. So yeah,
all on ultra on a 980 Ti, which is totally fine.
Yeah, on my rig at home, I got a Skylake i5 with a 1070 running at 4K and almost everything up to ultra. And yeah, it runs pretty smooth.
Yeah.
So.
No, I think it's really, I mean, they've really done a number on Frostbite in the past couple of years.
That's good.
Like, I think Battlefield 4's launch being such a catastrophe. Use a non-sweary language. that launch being such a catastrophe really made them go back to their technical side and try and, like, hammer Frostbite into some sort of, like, working condition.
That's good. That's good.
And we saw it with Battlefront last year. Battlefront launched and was totally solid, and now this is even better.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of stuff going on all the time, and I never have seen even like a hitch in my frame rate. So
nice. Well, I'm excited to play more. Obviously you beat, you know, everything, the reviews.
Yeah,
up.
Yeah, but I'm still playing multiplayer.
You're going to be deep into it for a
while. Yeah. Well, we got Civ code in yesterday and the whole time I was playing Civ last night, I was like, I could just play, I could play more Battlefield.
I could be playing Battlefield right now.
Like now I'm probably going to go home and play more Battlefield because I've gotten hooked again.
Nice. Awesome.
Well, yeah, I love it. It's really good.
Well, thanks for coming in and, doing a little video with us.
Let's do it again sometime.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks.